Thank you. It is so good to have you join with us at this same time each week. And again, we count it our privilege to be able to come into your homes and to share this time with you. We're going to get right into our message here as we continue on now on the subject here. Can you believe in God and still go to hell? Now, as we start out, we're going to take our first one here, and it's going to deal with three things. First of all, the great Apostle Paul, which most of you are all familiar with, how that this man hated God and so forth. The second is going to deal with a man by the name of Martin Luther, who claimed that you had to be baptized in order to be saved. And the reason we're including this in here, and also Paul's salvation, is that all three are wound up together. Other words, when we come to Paul being saved and so forth, we find out that Luther says that his baptism is what saved him and so forth, and he quotes from Acts chapter 22. So let's begin here and get right into this. And our point is to show that Paul was a religious man, but he was lost. Luther is a liar when he tells you and pulls one verse out of Scripture, completely out of context, and tells you that baptism saves you. And the second thing is to show the wonderful salvation that God gave to the Apostle Paul without baptism and him believing in the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior. So let's begin here, and we find out first, and we're going to give this right at the beginning here, because in Luther's catechism, and you will find in his small catechism on page 175, paragraph 630, he makes the statement here, "Arise and be baptized and wash away thy sins." This is what he says, and therefore uses that without any context whatsoever. So we're going to examine this and begin to find out here what do the Scriptures teach concerning this. The person in question is the Apostle Paul. The verse in question is that of Acts chapter 22 and verse 16, stating, "Arise and be baptized and wash away thy sins." So we have the person in the verse in question. Now we will seek to answer the question here, does faith in Christ alone save, or is it baptism that saves? To reach a definite conclusion, let us briefly examine Paul's life in three areas, which will bring us back to the answer in Acts chapter 22, verse 16. And the three areas are Paul's past reputation, Paul's present redemption, and Paul's future response. So let's look at Paul's past reputation first here. Let us allow the Scriptures to speak for themselves. In Acts chapter 7, Stephen was being stoned to death for his faith in Jesus Christ. Paul was part of it. In verse 58, he states, "And cast Stephen out of the city and stoned him, and the witnesses laid down their clothes at a young man's feet whose name was Saul." In Acts chapter 8, verse 1, right on, "And Saul was consenting unto his death." In Acts chapter 9, verse 1, "And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord." In Galatians chapter 1, and verse 13, notice what the Word of God says, "For we have heard, or you have heard of my conversation in times past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God, and I wasted it." Now here's Paul's words when he was arrested in Jerusalem concerning his past. But let me read you verse 14 first here, which goes along with that. "And I profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in my own nation, being much more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers." This is exactly what false teachers do today. Now we go on here, and what his words were when he was arrested in Jerusalem concerning his past. "And I persecuted this way, that is, Christians, unto death, binding and delivering them unto prisons, both men and women." Now, Paul's past, in summary, documented him as a blasphemer, a persecutor, and a murderer of Christians. Now we pick up and move on Paul's present redemption. In Acts chapter 9, we have recorded Paul's encounter with Jesus Christ as he was on his way to Damascus. It was at this meeting when Paul got saved. The record is found in Acts chapter 9 and verses 3 to 6. Let me read them to you. "And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth, and a voice was saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? Art thou Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest, for it's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do." Now, it's important to realize that the Greek word for Lord in these verses is the Greek word kurios, K-U-R-I-O-S. The first translation of the Old Testament scriptures into Greek was known as the Septuagint, as most of you know. Or if you haven't known, your pastor should have taught this to you. Whenever the translators came to translate the Hebrew word Jehovah, that is God, into the Greek, they used Kyrios. You see, Paul knew both Hebrew and Greek well, as Paul was his Greek name and Saul is his Hebrew name. He was known by both. Therefore, when the Lord asked Saul in verse 4, "Why persecutest thou me?" he thought it was Jehovah God speaking. For in verse 5, Saul answered, "Who art thou, Lord?" That is, Kyrios, Greek for Jehovah of the Old Testament. In other words, are you God? And the Lord said, "I'm Jesus whom thou persecutest." Paul immediately recognized that this was Jesus the Messiah, the Savior, being God manifested in the flesh. In verse 6, we have Saul's salvation recorded as he acknowledges Jesus as Jehovah God. Notice, "And he," that's Paul, "trembling and astonished, said, Lord," that's Kyrios, that's God. He said, "God, wilt thou, what wilt thou have me to do?" Paul had now changed his mind about Jesus Christ, whom he had previously thought to be a false teacher. He was now saved, as he later wrote in Romans 4, or chapter 5, verse 1, "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." You know, it only takes 1 second for you to change your destiny from hell to heaven. And that is, you may have had all doubts about the Bible. You may have had doubts about this or that or one thing or another. Maybe you've doubted the denomination you've been to. Maybe you went to church for years and so forth. And then, by the Holy Spirit, you look into the Bible and it says, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved." No baptism there. But Paul wrote, "Therefore, being justified by faith," faith, not baptism, "we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." Now, a short time later at Damascus, when Ananias met with Paul, he addressed him as Brother Saul. He was now recognized as a spiritual Christian brother in Christ, and that's found in Acts chapter 9, verse 17. Remember, Paul's now saved, but he has not yet been baptized. Luther disagrees with God's word, as he states in his catechism the following. We're pointing this out because this man was nothing more than a false teacher. Notice what it says in his large catechism, page 81, paragraph 6. "Moreover, it is solemnly and strictly commanded that we must be baptized or we shall not be saved." That's the great Martin Luther that everybody seems to worship, that has had the blinders pulled over their eyes and been quoted by men that have no idea what this man believes, and quote Martin Luther. I hear Lutheran preachers quote him all the time, and so forth. Don't they know what he believes? Or if they do, then they must believe the same thing, and they believe that unless you're baptized, you can't be saved. Well, that's a lie out of hell. Here again, Luther is found to be a liar and a false teacher, as Saul was already saved prior to his baptism. Always keep in remembrance the three proofs of Saul's salvation prior to his baptism. May I recapitulate for emphasis? Number one, in Acts chapter 9, verse 6, Saul called Jesus Lord, proof that he had repented, that is, the Greek metanoia, or changed his mind concerning Jesus being a false teacher, who was now his Savior. Also in Acts 9, 6, we find Paul the persecutor and murderer of those who followed Christ now wanted to serve the true and living God, Jesus the Messiah, proved by making his will known in the statement. Here's what Paul said, "Lord, what wilt thou have me to do?" And then in Acts chapter 9, verse 17, Ananias, recognizing that Paul was a chosen vessel of the Lord in verse 15, as Jesus had told him. Then in verse 17, Ananias, upon meeting Saul, addressed him as a brother in Christ by stating, "Brother Saul." Remember, Saul, or Paul, had never been baptized yet, but he was saved. Now, Paul's future response. From Paul being saved, now we're moving on to what Luther uses as far as Acts chapter 22, and says that baptism saves you. Now, Paul's future response, we're moving on now from Paul being saved in Acts chapter 9 until we reach chapter 22, several years have passed. He had made three missionary journeys, which began in Acts chapter 13, verse 2, and culminated in chapter 21, in verse 17, with his arrival back at Jerusalem. Now, let us return to our verse in question found in Acts chapter 22, and verse 16, where Paul is testifying about what Ananias said to him after he was saved. And now, why tarriest thou? Rise and be baptized, and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Now, how important it is to examine the context and the circumstances of a particular verse, which will always reveal the truth of a subject to the person who will be honest with the Scriptures and themselves. The subject matter in question, of which Acts chapter 22, verse 16 is a part, begins back in Acts chapter 21, where Paul goes to Jerusalem. It is here in the temple that the people apprehended Paul. And all of the city was moved, and the people ran together, and they took Paul and drew him out of the temple, and forthwith the doors were shut, in Acts 21:30. Paul was not in the inner sanctuary, but only in the outer court. They were beating Paul when he was saved by the chief captain and the soldiers, chapter 21, verse 32. As they were leading him to the barracks, the Roman soldiers were leading him there. Paul asked the chief captain for permission to speak to the people, chapter 21, verse 39 and 40. His testimony is recorded in chapter 22 in verse 20, or verse 1 to 21. The content of his testimony was relating what he had experienced earlier as recorded in Acts chapter 9. Now again, it is to be emphasized that Paul's salvation is evidenced by his acknowledgement of Christ as his Lord or Savior. He also testifies to the fact that Ananias addressed him as a spiritual brother since both were Christians. Notice in Acts chapter 22 and verse 13, Ananias came unto me and stood and said unto me, Brother Saul. That's Paul's own words. As noted, only the saved are spiritual brothers and sisters in Christ, and such was Paul. Since Paul was already saved, what did Ananias mean by telling Paul to be baptized and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord? It couldn't have been for salvation because he was already saved. But let's see what that is. One must remember that there is a judicial or positional justification of sin and a practical justification of sin. When Paul was saved, he received remission for all of his sins judicially. That is, Christ's death on the cross bore the eternal punishment for Paul's sins, past, present, and future. Notice in Romans 3:24 and 25, being justified, that means declared absolutely righteous, freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation, that is payment, through faith in his blood, not baptism, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. How simple the scriptures are. Ananias was instructing Saul, or Paul, as to how God wanted him to deal with his past sins, practically and publicly. Almost every Jew and Gentile knew of Paul's commitment and reputation concerning his persecution of Christians. Notice in Acts chapter 9, verse 1, and Saul breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord. And then in Acts chapter 22 and verse 19 and 20, where Paul is giving his testimony here. And I said, Lord, they know that I imprisoned and I beat in every synagogue them that believed on thee. And when the blood of thy martyr Stephen was shed, I also was standing by and consenting unto his death, and kept the raiment of them that slew him. You see, now that Paul is a Christian, his public profession of faith in Christ is of utmost importance, just as it is for every Christian. His baptism would be a public testimony of his faith in the death and the burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ. By his baptism, he was now publicly identifying himself with those Christians whom he once persecuted. You see, in baptism, being immersed shows death. Going under the water is death, and being raised out of the water shows resurrection. When Paul was baptized, it was his public testimony that he was not the same person he was before he met Christ on the road to Damascus. For he later wrote, therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. And let me say this here, too, to another false teaching of Luther, and that Now, whether Luther taught this or whether his preachers just picked it up through tradition, I believe that Martin Luther believed in, as far as baptism, in submersion. His preachers, I think, since that time have just went along with whatever's convenient for them and so forth by a little sprinkling of the water on the head of the baby or on the head of the adult or whatever. There is no sprinkling ever found as a mode of baptism in the Bible when it comes to baptism of a Christian, you see. Other words, when Paul quoted this here and said this in Romans 6:4, that we should walk in newness of life. And when you see me baptized, that is, you see me go under the water, you're seeing that I'm publicly identifying to you that my faith is in the death of Jesus Christ. When I'm raised out of the water, my faith is in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You see, the sins Paul was going to wash away were his acts of persecution against Christians prior to being saved. Judicially, Paul's sins were judged upon Calvary. Now they would be washed away publicly in the eyes of the Christians who knew of his conversion. This is made public by his baptism. You can rest assured that Paul gave his testimony at his baptism by calling on the name of the Lord in thanksgiving for saving such a sinner as he. I remember when I had trusted the Lord as my Savior, I wasn't the same person I was in high school and for a few years after high school. And I know it was my public profession. I'm not the same person I was. I don't do the same things that I did when prior to being saved. I'm not the same person anymore. And my baptism showing that, outwardly showing you by baptism, that I have trusted Jesus Christ as my Savior, you see. I'm not the same person anymore. I'm not going to do some of the things that I did prior to being saved. The sins of Paul's persecution against Christians would never be repeated again. His public profession from that time on washed away any doubt of those sins ever being repeated. God had taken a persecutor and made a preacher out of him. He had taken a murderer and made a missionary out of him. And he had turned a blasphemer into a blessing. God also used Paul to pen 14 of the 27 epistles of the New Testament. God, you see, had done this, and only the Lord can do this with a person. Yes, judicially, Paul's sins were accounted paid in full at the cross. Publicly, they were washed away, as there remained no doubt in the people's minds as to where he stood, remaining faithful to his Lord until his death. I've taken a little more time in this and quoted Luther's quote in Acts chapter 22, verse 16, "Arise and be baptized and wash away thy sins," to show the importance of reading the whole context surrounding a verse. Luther was a master of deceit at quoting parts and pieces of a verse and omitting the context in an attempt to make a support his false teaching of baptismal regeneration. Acts chapter 22, verse 16 is a classic example of one of Luther's deceptions. For some 460 years since Luther's death in 1546, his puppet preachers have preached his philosophy, leading untold millions into eternal damnation, thinking they are saved by being baptized. I have attended several Lutheran funerals, and I hear the same thing over and over again without exception. Remember their baptism. It should be, remember the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. But I haven't heard that. Luther labels those, and this is amazing, Luther labels those who disagree with him. That would be all of your, there are hundreds and thousands of preachers that preach the same thing we do. Over and over again, I see them on television, I read their literature and so forth there. And Billy Graham doesn't agree with Luther. Maybe Billy Graham's wrong too, you suppose? You know? But Luther says anybody that disagrees with him, they're foolish and they're know-it-alls. And he says that in his Large Catechism, page 84. So he hopes you read the catechism and you'll believe him instead of looking into the Bible for yourself. But God's answer to Luther and every other false teacher is this: let the lying lips be put to silence, which speak grievous things proudly and contemptuously against the righteous. You see, Luther's crown jewel for his pseudo-doctrine of baptismal regeneration turns out to be nothing more than a rhinestone, a piece of cheap glass. I might say this, I hope you're not following Martin Luther. I run from the man. I don't want anything to do with the man at all whatsoever. This is just the tip of the iceberg of what this man perverted the Bible, and yet, by the power of Satan, has made a god to the Lutherans. If Luther says it, that settles it. Well, that doesn't settle it, folks. What God says settles it. And I would only suggest to you that you look in your Bible and make your decision. The Word of God says in the middle verse of the Bible, in Psalms 118:8, it's better to put your trust in the Lord than to put confidence in men. No, I don't believe what Luther teaches about water baptism whatsoever. In fact, Luther goes on to say, you don't even have to have faith, just as long as you are baptized. It doesn't matter whether you have faith or not. You ought to read your large catechism. That's unbelievable when I show that to people. They can't believe it. A misfit man like Luther, and that's exactly what he was, a false teacher, could even make a statement like that. And yet the Bible says without faith it's impossible to believe God. And yet Luther says it doesn't matter whether you have faith or not. Just as long as you've been baptized, you can't render your baptism invalid. Unbelievable. Well, I might say this. You have the opportunity, if you wish to do it, you can get mad, rant and rave and all of that, and yell and scream, call the radio station, do whatever you want to do, and all that, which you might do. You know, that's your repercussion. That's usually what you do out of knowledge, lack of knowledge, I should say. Or maybe you'd like to look in your Bible. Maybe you'd like to get a copy of the tape. Maybe you would like to go over it with a fine-tooth comb and see that Mr. Lutheran had lied to you in his catechism when he said, arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, and tells you that your baptism saves you, when it had nothing to do with it whatsoever. It was be baptized because you will never repeat the persecution that you did against Christians, you see. We have 13 of those articles on there exposing this false teacher. If you'd like to look at them, you can look it up on our website if you wish to. It's www.heritagebbc.com. Since we put those on there, we have had long-distance calls from Germany. Thank you, Pastor Jans, for putting this on. I was raised a Lutheran. I'm now a Christian. Thank you for putting them on. Nobody exposes this man as a false teacher. And we talked about 35, 40 minutes. You see, we had another from New Jersey, long-distance phone call from looking on the Internet. This is unheard of. We get emails all the time from articles that we put on the Internet. Very rarely do you get a long-distance phone call from Germany and thanking you for putting this on and exposing this false teacher of Martin Luther. And he was just ecstatic. And we thank the Lord for that. You see, it just depends on whether you want to know the truth or whether you don't. But I'll tell you this, better put your trust in the Lord than it is a dead man. It's been dead for some 460 years. This man's been dead. And if the Lutherans say, and their preachers say, well, we don't really believe that, then why are you passing out literature that contradicts what you believe? Why are you still passing out this junk in the catechism here that is built upon one lie after another? Why are you still passing it out if you don't believe it, you see? Every time you pin one of them down, they always back up. Well, Luther changed his mind. Show me where he changed his mind. I've read his stuff, the Augsburg Confession, everything else. Luther never changed his mind. If he changed his mind, why didn't you change the catechism? You see, all of these are cop-outs from false teachers that follow their leader, a false leader by the name of Martin Luther. You'll find a volume, a wealth of information on there that most of you Lutherans absolutely have no idea about Martin Luther, what this man really believed. Well, so much for that. We'll continue on because we want to examine many other things about those who say, yes, I believe in God. Are they going, does that save them? No, it doesn't save them. They go right to hell. They must believe what God said to believe. And God gave his only begotten Son, and the only begotten Son said in John 14:6, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh to the Father but by me. Not by the water, but by me and the blood I shed upon Calvary. We hope you'll take time to write. Our mailing address is the Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Until next week at the same time, keep looking up as we ever pray, even so come, Lord Jesus.